But remember, nothing is as it seems in this world. It's the mind that believes in the ego, that believes in the competition, which generates the guilt, and then the guilt is projected out onto the body. So the injury, as I said before, all illnesses are mental illnesses. The injury is actually caused by guilt in the mind. It has absolutely nothing to do with the body's colliding. You know, that's just projection, as if the source of the injury is in the world. Or people will say, well, don't stay out in the sun too long, you know, because of the radiation, and you know, there's this thing about getting cancer from too much exposure to the sun and so forth. It's a dream, and there's these spurious cause-effect relationships where it seems to be that there's a cause in the environment in relationship to the body, or in the genetics even within the body, in terms of history, that has something to do with the illness or the injury. And what I'm telling you is it has nothing to do with the injury or the illness. All illness, in terms of form, is just a projection of guilt in the mind. And that's why forgiveness is so important. When you're doing your forgiveness practice, you talk about a health insurance policy. Forgiveness is the best health insurance policy there can be, because it removes the guilt from your mind, and that's what causes the illness. Just the feeling of guilt doesn't feel good. Guilt and shame and so forth. Psychologically, you might say that's your best psychotherapy, is forgiveness. And then, in basic terms too, when we talk about special relationships, the ego uses the body for pride and for pleasure and for attack. So, you know, if you find that you can honestly look at your life and you can start looking at your motives for doing things, your purposes underneath, if you trace the motives down into your mind and you can find those motives, pride and pleasure and attack, that is what is keeping you from knowing the peace and joy and happiness of God. Those motives are basically ego motives, and when you follow the ego and its advice and teachings, you keep the guilt in your mind and your consciousness instead of releasing it. And then the ego says, get rid of it. Project it out onto the world. As if you can get it out of your mind by projecting it to the world. And, you know, I think a lot of us can relate to this in real simple terms. Like when I was a little kid, I remember I would go to church, but I really wasn't so thrilled with church, going to church, having to go to church every week. And I remember some weeks where I would just sit home and think, I really don't want to be there. I really do not want to be at that church. And I remember I started on maybe Saturday night or Sunday morning, where I would go into my mind and just over and over, I don't want to be there, I don't want to be there, I don't want to be there. And I could work myself into quite a fever by Sunday morning, so much so where it'd be, and then get mom to come in and feel the forehead and go, oh, I don't know, I don't feel so good. And she'd say, oh, you've got a fever. And it was just a good example of projection, where there was something unresolved within, and then actually using sickness to get out of something. You can see that it's part of an ego motive. Instead of just saying, I don't want to go to church and I'm not going, and facing whatever would come from that, it seems safer to work up a little bit of a fever there. You know, and that's because sickness is an insane decision, you know. It's almost like you're trying. There's a motive underneath it that's not pure. It's not authentic, and it's not clear. So, I think that pride, pleasure, and attack. I had many, many lessons in my life in relationships where I see that the pride of wanting to have it my way, wanting things to work out a certain way, or wanting to have control. about humility, you know, that's that was a major theme for many years. The jobs that I took, the relationships I had, just got more and more humbling. You know, the teaching of the course is, would you rather be right or happy? And every time you want to be right, it's the ego and its own pride that wants to be right about something, wants to win an argument, wants to have the satisfaction of saying, oh, but I was right. I told you so. You know, that's the old I told you so motive. Or finding fault to protect and defend something. The attack motive is pretty obvious. I mean, I think, again, most people look at something like as horrendous as war, and they see bodies being shot and stabbed and blown up and so on and so forth, and it's just the insanity of that. But remember, it's not really the bullets or the bayonets, it's not the bombs or the grenades, it's not what seems to be happening in form, where the attack is, but it's the attack thoughts in the mind. The judgments in the mind is what we could say is where the attack is. And this world was made to almost displace attack thoughts and to try to, you might say, dilute them. Like, there's only one really, one attack thought we could really talk about, and that's the belief that you separate from God and make yourself different than God created you to be. But that attack thought is so major, and it is so horrific, that it's completely buried out of awareness. You just don't hear people when they say they're having a bad day. Well, yeah, I think I attacked God. People don't, that's not something that's in conscious awareness. I believe I attacked God. So that's pushed way out of awareness. And then a world is made up where there seems to be lots of little attacks, little glances and glares, little irritations and annoyances that sometimes boil over to interrupt in terms of being flashes of anger or rage. It's like basically rage is just, you might say, just an irritation or annoyance. It's like a veil drawn over intense rage. That really what Jesus is teaching us is that there's no difference between minor annoyance and rage. Everything that's upsetting for you is a block to your awareness of divine love and grace and peace. And then you have to give them up entirely. So you can't believe that some attacks are justified and others are not. You can't believe that there are certain cases where you should defend yourself and certain cases where you don't need defense. That healing is never partial. So that's why when we go into something like a topic like anger or attack, you just have to be taken so deep into your mind that you come to a state where you realize the possibility of attack. It won't do you any good as long as you still believe that attack is possible, because you always get defensive whenever you perceive an attack. But that takes a lot of practice in the sense of, I know in my life, I've had seemingly countless different scenarios and situations that have come up. But to reach a state where you are so identified with mind that you don't perceive a physical attack or a psychological attack, then that takes a lot of practice, because that's what keeps the guilt in place, is this belief in attack. You really have to have two for an attack. You have to have an attacker and an attackee. In forgiveness and the happy dream, there just isn't the two. We were talking before about you're unified with everything and everyone, so there's no two. So attack has no ability to exist as a concept